All right. For you YouTube followers on Extreme Angler fan page, this is what I'm going to be doing this afternoon. Throwing these things right here. And here's the color combinations I have. Everybody in the world uses black and blue. I've got green with some tinsel. I've got almost like a green pumpkin with green. And I got green, dark green with green. So you know what the color money is? The color money is bass. It's largemouth bass. And for me, I try to keep it real simple. Years ago, like I said before, I had 30, 40 pounds of jigs in my jig box just to have them. They just got rusty, they got old, threw them out. I want to stick with things that give me focus and concentration. The black and blue, only because fish aren't that smart and it has contrasting with shadows and stuff. I fish just in a lot more darker water. But I fish a lot of Northern Ontario stuff, and it's got a lot of real clear water, a lot of trout-based things. So you sometimes you just got to, I'm not matching the hatch, but what I'm doing is giving something that looks natural. So the green hues in the water, they almost have like a transparency. They're not overbearing. The black and blue will still catch fish 100%. But the greens, the green pumpkins, the olives, and that kind of stuff, matched up a little jig, those are the ones that I'm going to be throwing this afternoon on this lake in Northern Ontario. So let me show you my jig selection, what weights, what trailers, how I do it, so you can do it. I have to get shallow. Oh my goodness, eh? Think things want the buzzbait? Coming for green and getting brown. Look at that. Eh? This thing just makes noise and it drives fish psycho, man. He even missed it too. Little smallmouth. Man, he's warmer than the air. Early summer, post-spawn. Fish can be, weird moods, but provoking baits, provoking strikes right there, like the buzz bait, the frog. I got some jigs and plastics, but we're gonna try that horizontal approach and the vertical approach. My 1-2 punch today. Horizontal and vertical. Horizontal so you can see the bites, and vertical, watching the line go, and hopefully getting some big black largemouth up here in Northern Ontario. So sit back, relax, I'll show you how I do it, so you can do it, and you got more ammunition, more baits, and more options for more bass. Let's go. Let me tell you why I'm throwing the buzzbait first thing. It's low ceiling. What does that mean? It means it rained for 4 days straight. It means the fish have been hibernating. Now, some people use that as an excuse, like the east wind. Not me. When it's a cold front, I want to go. So the temperature's supposed to rise, sun's supposed to come out. Until that happens, this right here is a fantastic search bait. It finds aggressive ones, finds the ones that are roaming, who come off the trees and docks and rocks and stuff like that. So these fish, potentially, right up tight along the shoreline, looking for crayfish and baitfish, whatever it is. But when the sun comes up, maybe they go into those hiding spots. Well, I've got my plastics and jigs to pry them out. But until that happens, I'm going to have some fun, man, with the frog and the buzzbait. There it is. The classic leadhead jig, flipping jig, pitch jig, whatever you want to call it. This is the bait that probably caught more big bass of all time in North America over the years. And there's all different kinds of different finesse baits out there, but you'll still catch bass with the jig. Trust me, they're not that smart. But it's a matter of putting this little bait into areas that are ambush. Like, what are ambush spots? Trees, overhanging bush, rock, docks, you name it. This bait is so versatile. I mean, you can fish from 2 feet to 20 feet. So what I'm going to do this afternoon on the small lake in Northern Ontario is it's got lots of rock. It's got fallen, sunken wood, I guess, from years of trees falling down. So there'll be different depths from 6 feet to about 9-10. We've had a lot of rain, so there's a lot of bushes that normally are dry, that now they get about 2.5-3 feet of water. So you know I'm going to put the jig in those spots too, because the reaction bites. That jig's falling, going down, it's just something on their kitchen table. I don't care what it resembles, just something that they can see, and largemouth are opportunistic. So I'm going to throw the jig, show you what I use, how I fish it, so you can fish it. You can catch them too. Let's see if I can bring a fish up, dude. There's got to be someone on that log, dude. Has to be. I'll have to pick up a plastic. I know y'all want to see him on a buzz bait. So do I. But boy, oh boy, when you see a log or a stump like that, there's got to be somebody on it. Things with this low ceiling, it's like, it's 50-50 when it's low ceiling like this, because stumps like that, these trees and stuff, you have to fish it. So you either pick one or two. I'm going to do both. Buzz bait for excitement and the jig, because sometimes when it's like this, they're roaming more, so the buzz bait will find them, or the frog. When they're on the structure, when the sun comes out, the jig and plastics and stuff, but never say never, you know, because a spot like this right here could have a monster on it. Why would I go buy it if I didn't get a blow up on the buzz bait? Got to be prepared. Even these trees, look how deep they are. We've had a lot of rain, and it's 7 feet deep. All it takes is one pitch. I'll work these edges. Because when you find the big ones, like that. On the jig too, eh? Back here. Not a bad start, eh? Look where he's got that too. Just finished saying under the trees, eh? He wanted that jig. Hard to beat the jig boy for bass. Hey, a little half ounce. Got me a good, I don't know, 3+. Look at the big heads on these fish. The potential to be real big, eh? Just gorgeous. Here, I'm going to put you over here so you can go to the stump. And maybe I'll catch you or your cousin later. Go on. One, two, one, two. Buzz bait and jig. So like I was saying, I got to throw that buzz bait on the edge of the bushes with a flood of trees. Maybe not get a strike, but you never go by it. So I got the jig. I got the frog and the buzz bait. Gonna have some fun. These three things right here, gonna put some bass in the boat for me today. Even when the sun comes out, be even better. Let's keep going. All right, little half ounce rattle flipping jig, okay? Typical weed guard, but when I'm fishing stuff that's fairly open, the trees and stuff, and I'm not putting in real heavy weed, so I'll take the weed guard. It's got about, I don't know, 20 little strands, and I'll take my little scissors and I'll just cut off on an angle, just like that, okay? So I still got the tip over the guard. You can flare it if you want, but I'm not gonna flare it because I'm gonna be putting it in dangerous spots, trees and stuff, and bushes underneath trees and stuff, so who knows what's there. See the skirt? Too long for me. I need to give it a haircut, and then I'll put on the trailer and I'll show you how it looks when I put the trailer on. At the very back, I cut them a little bit shorter like that, so when it's in the water, they stick up like the old spider jigs. Okay, what's on the back of my jigs? There are a couple options today. It's post-spawn. The fish are like in a funk. You know, there's no excuses about catching largemouth, especially on jigs. You know what? Either you get bit or you don't get bit. That's the way it goes. But to put the odds in my favor, the fish aren't super aggressive. You know, they're in that sulky mood. I'm going to tone down the size of my little chunks. Use like a little junior chunk. So I got green pumpkin, okay? A little bit of black flake. I got like a summer craw, which has got their green pumpkin and stuff, but it's got that bright chartreuse offset. And then my third choice, a little like a crayfish kind of bait, small tender little body, big flapping little claws. Hopefully one of these things on my jigs will get a reaction bite. Saw you come out of there, eh? He's got one good eye, one bad eye, but he saw the jig. Look. Yep. Ooh, he's been caught a few times. Wow. You are a little warrior. Better watch it, little bass, eh? Better watch it. Go on. Oof, picking it apart. This has been one of the latest long spawns I've seen in a long time in Ontario. Seriously, I'm seeing beds. There's nothing on them, but there's beds like everywhere. And the smallmouths usually spawn a little bit earlier, so it gotta be late largemouth. So I'm having to pick up that jig. Got one little pop on the buzz bait. Got some smallmouth on the buzz bait. But as soon as I pick up that jig, put it in all the nasty. I mean, every fish has come off either real thick stuff or bushes 5 feet from shore. So I'll expand on that, look for that stuff, go catch some fish. So when I'm fishing the jig like this, little coves like this, I'm looking for that tapering edge. I'm in 6 feet, right there tapers up to about 3. But that little taper, if it's got logs, it's got some weed patches and stuff, largemouth don't need a lot of stuff. I mean, they do not need a lot. If their back is wet, they find a little ambush spot, make sure that jig goes in those spots. Overhanging cedar trees. Still 6 feet of water. Not fishing in a lake that's got like tea color. So it's got color. The fish feel safe. Ooh, there's even stumps here. Logs and stumps. Right here. Wow. It's just unbelievable, man, how many places you can put the jig. And if a bass is there, he's gonna try to eat it. Okay, let me show you how I put the little junior chunk on my half-ounce jig. So I'll push down on the weed guard, take the jig like that, right in the center. I push it down, and then I bring it through between the legs, turn it around, and watch how I just push it. Marry it right up inside with the hook shaft and the rattle. It sits nice and snug, doesn't come down. And look at that profile right there. That right there is a deadly presentation for largemouth bass. See what I mean? Just a small little patch of weed. Fish the same stuff on the other side of this little bay with nothing. Look, we've got that jig too. Come to this side, boom, right away, as soon as you go in there. So, gotta always read the water. He's not big, but look what I call him, largemouth. Look at that. Hey, pound and a half fish, but a big, beautiful head. The DNA potential for big, that's why I look at. Right there, go on, buddy, go on. Could have been 4, but he's a pound and a half. That's the nasty stuff right there. Find little patchy stuff like that, you'll catch them with the jig. All right, when I'm fishing that jig along shorelines and pounding away, and this lake's got clear water too. If you look over here, it's next to nothing. Rocks coming along, but then you got some reeds. And you got high water, and you say, well, how high is high? If it's 18 inches, 15 inches, I'm pitching. Because this is the kind of stuff those nasties will find. Little pockets like this. You got reeds back here, arrowheads going to eelgrass, tapering out to deeper water. But it's very, very important to put your bait in this kind of nasties back there. Because the big guys, when they're aggressive, yeah, they'll sit out here on the edge of the arrowhead. When they're not aggressive, like the little hiding spots they like to hide in, they'll hide in those black holes back there. Those little black holes are very, very important. When they're aggressive, everyone catches them out here in this stuff right like there, right there, okay? But when they're not aggressive, those bigger ones, up in this stuff. And with the jig, I'll just keep fishing it. I'm not soaking it. Just putting it right in. If they're there, they will bite it right away. There's no ifs or buts about it. When it lands, get ready, shake it once or twice. And I missed one right there. I don't know how big, I don't know how small, but he was there, right back in the thick of it. So next time you go around, fish that stuff, try not to miss him. Now, how to pull those nice big fat largemouth out of those bushes. Okay, the 7.3, 7.4, 7.6 St. Croix Legend Tournament Bass, low profile reel, and I don't play around whatsoever. Brand new fresh Gamma Edge, fluorocarbon, 20 pound. Because you see where I'm pulling these fish out of? It's like nasty stuff. And big largemouth, once they get over 3 pounds, they got that attitude, they will never come right at you. They'll go sideways, turn around, under the log, over the log. You gotta have a line that you can trust. And I'm telling you, I fished all the lines that are out there. I stuck with Gamma. They make fantastic products. Test them with your favorite brands and see how the texture, the quality of it, nice and smooth for pitching and stuff, but you just can't break this stuff. That 20 pound is my go-to line. But you just gotta dissect everything. You see a log, hit it from all four, five, six different sides of it. It's not one pitch. Learn to dissect the stuff and you'll catch way more bass with a jig. The important thing is when you're fishing these bushes and stuff like that, you see the dark areas. I don't care if it's 3 inches deep or 3 feet deep. If you can't see the bottom, there could be a largemouth there. You got flooded trees, you know, the water levels come up and stuff. The largemouth just know it. They just know it. They pull into that stuff. It's nice and dark. They're waiting for something to come along, you know, unsuspecting bait fish, frogs, crayfish. I don't care. Thing, all I care about is putting that little jig in those black spots as far back under those overhanging bushes and trees as I can. Oh, come on. Come on. This is a big bubble spot. Can't tell me there's no bass around here. Oh my God. Oh my goodness me. Oh, get ready, dude. This has to have fish somewhere here. Has to. Just like that. Mr. Big Mouth on the jig, eh? Let's put the poles down for a second. I tell you, when you fish the right trees, the rain subsides. That's what the jig can do right there. Whew! Just the familiar dunk. I know, buddy. I know. Just look how nice and long these fish are, eh? Just gorgeous. Gorgeous, gorgeous bass. I'll let you go, right? Huh? Let you go. I know we're going to catch bigger ones. But that's the deal right there. Catching the big mouth bass. One. Buzz bait. Kept trying it, man. Honestly, for about like an hour. Hour plus. Just going and going and going. And nothing. You know, smallmouth. Few jumps. And we had severe cold front. But I told you before, I like fishing cold fronts. Why? Because the fish eat. And the ones you catch look like that. The jig in the nasty is going to catch them. Let's keep going. Now, why do I fish the jig? If you don't see why, you know what? You probably won't get it. That's not a derogatory statement. That's just the way it is. Some guys have it in their DNA to pick this up. You know why? It's so fun stalking down largemouth with this. Like I could throw a little creature bait, a worm. It just hasn't got the same appeal. Something about picking up that jig, you know, heavy power, casting rod. I just feel like I'm fishing for big fish. And these largemouth haven't got any real big giants, but those high threes, 4 pounds, when you hit them, the dynamic fight is so short, and that's what it makes your adrenaline go. That's what hooks you on largemouth. So fishing with the jig in these overhanging bushes, these flooded trees and stuff like that, something about the jig, because that big wide hook right there, the hooking percentages are huge. There's no plastics to ball up, and the fish, remember, they're in the ambush positions. So you pick the best spot when you go around, look for the darkness, try to get a spot if you can that's for you and the fish. I do put it over branches and things like that because I don't want to move around a lot where I'm on a tree or etc. I've got the poles down, but I'll pitch in the dangerous stuff after. But I try to keep that position where it's me and the fish. So if I do get a real big one, there's a good chance that I can pull them away from some real nasty stuff. I got the confidence in the rod, confidence in the line, and that big bite hook. And I'm fishing the stuff that's visual. When I see on the shoreline trees busted off, or I'll look up sometimes, if the tree's halfway, where is it? In the water? Then you got a tree like this right here. It's got the branches that come out here. The base of it's in about 2 feet, right there, about six. Wow. Fishing all the arms of it coming down. Putting the jig down, watching the jig, bouncing it. This isn't about soaking the jig, but putting it in there, bouncing it. If he's there, he's going to eat it. Okay, when I'm pitching this kind of stuff, I've got rocks tapering down. I'm not going to soak it. It's okay. So pitch out about 8 feet, watching it go down, and I'm shaking it, popping it. See that? Very aggressive. I want to get their attention. That jig just pops, goes down. You're lucky sometimes if they hit it on the drop. Sometimes you're just going like this, you're lifting up, and he's already there. So you get their attention by just working it, hopping it, and they just inhale it on the drop. You lift up, they're there. That's why the heavy power rod. A lot of times it's not perfect, where you feel the actual bite, the whole deal. Sometimes you're just lifting back and forth. Having the heavy power, or extra heavy, you can just lean back and make sure that heavy gauge hook finds its mark. Big largemouth on it. Yeah. Largies love rock. You put rock and weed, you're in the middle of a lake. Look where I am. I'm like in the middle of the lake. You still eat the jig. And I'm in, 9 feet of water. Tell you about the jig, eh? We're catching them in 2 feet and 8 feet. Oh, there you are. You're just a little chunky one, but I love them, man. One jig. Almost finished my day. So it's versatile. Everyone loves it. Some days you get 5-pounders, some days you get fours and threes, but boy oh boy, you cannot beat the jig for versatility, working all through the water column, up, down, you name it. Let's see if we can get a couple more fish and call it an afternoon. Never pass a swim raft. Because if there's brown ones, they'll find it. Brown ones like the jig, don't they? Just like the largemouth. Could have set hook there on a giant largemouth, but on a beautiful Northern Ontario smallmouth, they love the jig the same way. See how I worked that too? Nothing special, but what I was doing was swimming it. Not letting it go to the bottom. I'm about 10 feet of water there. So swimming it gets their attention a bit more. Oof. And that jig, when it finds its mark, boy. There it goes. Look how dark those fish are, eh? Right there. So when I'm fishing those kind of things, like swim rafts, traditionally, you know, when I'm fishing the bushes and stuff, throw in, hit the bottom, bounce it. But when I'm throwing to these rafts like this, I'll show you exactly what I was doing. So pitching out, go down about 2 feet and swimming it, bouncing it. Because the fish would probably be high on that thing. It was like 10 feet deep. It's a different way to fish it.